Okay, so today we are going to study about rigid body, yeah? And I will share the screen. Remember, if you have question, just inform me, yeah, by using the chat or just interrupt my lecture, yeah, anytime. Okay, view display full screen mode. Okay. Okay. So, can you listen to my voice and follow the screen? Yeah. Is everything
yes,
okay?
Yeah, nice. Yes, all clear.
Good. So, yeah, this is a nice picture over the right here. Yeah. So we have someone who is lying or just putting his hands, his body weight over a very huge object, which is at rest. But actually, you see the object is also very, very fragile. Yeah, because it's only supported by, you can see the weight is supported by just a small area. Yeah, so there is a possibility that this object may fall in the future and produce some danger to humans. Yeah, and also we maybe you already heard in or watch how people, for example, in circus, yeah, can move in a rope, yeah, so above the rope just only by bare feet and using some kind of balance, yeah, in also in the construction workers, yeah, when they try to work in the very high area, they have to follow some procedure where they have to follow the safety regulations, yeah, because of the danger involved in their job. So daily lives is very closely connected with the rigid body and equilibrium, yeah. So as you can see, for example, there's a nice picture of a Balinese woman who use some weight on above the head, yeah, and they walk with this yeah, quite comfortably, even though they have a quite heavy weight. Yeah, so this is one of the example where the principle of equilibrium, principle of balance, yeah, is applied in daily life. And you can see that even though they have a huge lot of fruits and food above their heads, yeah, they can still walk and also yeah, even they look very happy, yeah. So you also see some people, for example, bringing some fruits using this weight, yeah. And yeah, so it is very possible that yeah, they can, for example, carry, yeah, those weight, because we learn later that there is involved equilibrium principles, yeah. And one of the principles that you will learn today is about the torque, yeah, or torca, yeah, the torque, which is connected to rotational equilibrium, yeah. So today, after the lecture, I hope that you understand what is translation motion and rotational motion analogy. There are many many same common grounds, yeah, or some analogies between the translation and rotational motion. You will learn the equivalence of net force in rotational motion, which is called the torque, yeah, and also the rotational dynamics. So we learn the moment of inertia, which is related to the inertial mass, but for rotational bodies, yeah. So you will learn about the rigid body equilibrium, the concept of center of gravity, and the mechanical machine. Okay. Okay. So life would be just boring if there is no rotation. Yeah, everything around us actually rotates. For example, the atoms, who constitutes our body and everything that has matter. The atoms actually consist of electrons that is in constant motion. Yeah. they are constantly rotating around the nuclei. Yeah. Also, see, our Earth is also always rotating with regard to its own axis and also rotating relative to the sun. Yeah. So actually, a rotational motion is very close to everyday experience. Yeah. So, and one of the problems that we have to solve is about translational equilibrium in two dimension. For example, we have a weight which is connected to two ropes, yeah, and to a common wall or object here. We see we can calculate, yeah, the tension of the rope, yeah, by using Newton's law, as you have already experienced during senior high school years. By applying the net force in the x and y axis, because the object is at rest, yeah, we have no motion in the x and also in the y axis, so the resultant force logically must be zero, yeah, along the x and also along the vertical y axis, yeah, and this we can solve, yeah, by drawing the forces first, yeah. We first have to identify and draw all the forces, which is better if we can separate the forces first, the horizontal and the vertical components, yeah. So we need information about the sinus and cosinus. As you may see, sinus, yeah, if we have triangle like this, and we have an angle, yeah, say theta here, yeah, if this is A, this is B, and this is C, we know from trigonometry basic that sinus theta is equal to what? Sinus theta is equal to, yeah, maybe you still remember, equal to A divided by C, right? Whereas for cosinus, we have B divided by C. Tangen is A divided by B. So if we want to know the horizontal components, yeah, this is 90 degree, the horizontal components is the B component. B is given from this point as C cos theta is equal to B, and here we have C sinus theta is equal to A, yeah. So if this is the force along the A, this is the force along the horizontal, so we just put here the F here, so just multiply the force here, yeah, with sinus theta or with cosinus theta, depending on what we want to know. Yeah, we want to know the vertical or we want to know the horizontal. Yeah. So in this case, yeah, we want to know, yeah, the horizontal and vertical. Yeah. The horizontal force in this case is then cosinus, right? Because cosinus is this x divided by tb, yeah, and here in this case cosinus is minus x here divided by ta, so we have one of the positive and one of the negative, yeah, negative usually is to the left, yeah, positive usually to the right. So here in this case, yeah, it's just given here, the horizontal components is given by cosinus, the vertical component is given by sinus. We have one vertical downwards, which is the weight, and we have two vertical upwards, which is the rope tension, right? And for the horizontal, we have two forces, which is the right tension component of the horizontal, which is cosinus, and the left component of the tension, which is the horizontal left component, which is the cosinus too. Yeah, so this is not too hard because they are opposite, they must equal out, yeah, and also TBY plus TIY must equal to V. So we have here the condition TAX plus TBX is equal zero and TBY plus TAY this is minus TAX is minus and this case V is minus must equal to zero. We have two condition here. First is the horizontal or sigma FX is equal to zero. Second condition is the vertical sigma FY is equal to zero. Is given by this. So we have this equilibrium condition where the total forces of the horizontal and vertical must be zero. This is the translational equilibrium. The translational, not the rotational. There is another point which we will discuss later. So if we move on with the condition, then we have, as I said before, to fulfill these two equations. So we want to know, what is the problem here? What we want to know is to calculate the rope tension. Calculate the rope tension. Rope tension means we have to find out TA and TB. To see TA and TB, can be found in this equation. So if in the problem we know the mass or the weight of the object, if we know the mass, we know the weight of the object, just multiply by gravity acceleration, then we can find out the value of TA and TB by doing this mathematical substitutions. We can find TA and TB summation because we know W, the weight. If we know this equation, we can substitute into the earlier equation above to solve for TB and TA. So using this coupled equation, we can find out the value of TA and TB. The main principle is that these two net forces must be zero. So we solve the coupled equation by doing the substitution. This is just regular algebra. When you do this problem, and you can arrive at this equation here. It just follows from logical deduction. So we have this equation, and then you just find, for example here, if you know that the mass is, for example, 10 kilogram. In this case, the mass is 10 kilogram. So the weight is just mass times gravity, which is 100. So this here is the weight. Is mass times gravity. If the mass is known to be 10 kilogram, multiply by 10 meter per second square, you have 100. And from this 100, you have this equation. You know that sinus 53 is around 0.8. And cosinus 53 is 0.6, I think. Cosinus 37 is 0.8. I think cosinus 37. Maybe I'm wrong, or I 0.8. Cosinus 53 is 0.6, I think. So you have 0.8, 0.6 here. What I want to tell you is that you know this 100 here. You can have this equation here, and then you substitute this TB into the previous equation. So TB you can TB you can find out by the FYX. Yeah. So F this is FX is equal zero. From this you can then have this equation and put this TB then into the second equation, which is FY is equal zero. Yeah, this is called substitution. Yeah, because you have two linear equation, and then you have two unknowns in linear algebra. You have two unknowns, then you require at least two linear equation to solve this unknown. You have these two unknowns, but you have these two equations, so it's enough to find the value of the TB and TA. Okay, so if you do the calculation, you should arrive at this point. The best way to study is to experience yourself. So if you have a drawer in your hand, you have a piece of paper in your hand, you just draw and do your calculation by yourself. Yeah, this is the best way to study, which is the first-hand experience. For example, I can give you all the theories of swimming, but at the end, you have to go into the water and do yourself. So if you have opportunity and you have piece of paper, please take a piece of paper and try to do it by yourself. Yeah, and if you can do it, this means that you already understand. So this is pure translational motion. Yeah, in pure translational motions, yeah, you can apply Newton's law on the point which is called the mass, gravity mass, or the concentration of the total mass. Yeah. So if, for example, for a human body, it is not the same for man and woman. Yeah, because of the different geometry. Yeah. Men usually have a lower equilibrium center of mass. Yeah, we call it the center of mass than the woman. Yeah, you can imagine that woman body has a different distribution of mass than the man. Yeah, so the amount of center of gravity location is not the same, slightly different. Yeah. So the center of mass or the center of gravity is the point where we can apply Newton's law as if all our body are moving like a particle, yeah, like a point. So for example, if in this picture, yeah, you have a person which has not a particle geometry, yeah, not a particle shape of body, but the motion follow Newton's law, yeah. We follow Newton's law as long as we consider, yeah, as long as we consider the point of gravity. Yeah, the point of gravity in this case is the points marked in the dark dots here. So for the case of for example a rock, yeah, for the case of a rock, yeah, if we understand this is the center of gravity, all the motion can be analyzed as if it is a particle, if we know that the location of the center of mass or the center of gravity. Yeah. So general motion is a combination of translation and rotation motion. So general motion, yeah, in general motion, there is also involved not only translation, yeah, but also there is a change in the rotation. Yeah, it's a combination, therefore, of translation and rotational motion. As you can see here, now there is a deep connection between rotation and linear motion. You can see at the table here that the rotational motion has the same equation as the linear motion, just by substitution. If you know the relation, yeah, you have a circle here. Okay, I draw a circle. And then you have this point, which is the center of the circle. And here you have what we called the radius. Yeah, the radius. And for example, at one time, it moves from this point A to this point B. Yeah. The radius stay unchanged, but there is a motion from A to B. So you have here the theta, which is the angle. Theta, you can see, can be found. Here is the distance. So the distance, the arc, yeah, that is observed is equal to the radius times theta. Yeah, the distance is like the radius times theta, and theta here is in radian. Okay. What is radian? Radian is a measure of degree of rotation, but using the international system, which is already in the units of meters. Yeah. So for example, in one encircle, atau one times you circle the full from A back to A, the full circle is given by 2πr. Yeah. So when you calculate radian for one circle, then pi here is equal to 3,14. Yeah. Times r, for example, if r is 1 meter, yeah, just take an example, r is 1 meter, times 1 meter times 2, which is 6.28 meter. So radian means for one full circle, you already travel at distance of 6.28 meters. So you don't have to use degree anymore. You have to use this radian unit. Yeah. So radian unit is already compatible with meter and compatible with multiplication of radius. Yeah. So as you can see, there is a close relation between the motion or displacement S here and in rotation is equal to theta. So theta is analogous, yeah, not equal, analogous with the displacement. So what is analogous with the velocity? The velocity is analogous in rotation with the angular velocity. Yeah. So in linear motion, simple linear motion, you have this formula S is equal to V times R. And in rotation, you just change S into theta is equal to omega times R. Sorry, V times the time. Here you have omega times the time. So you have to in radian the amount of degree that has already been spent. Yeah. For example, 2 radian per second. Radian per second means every seconds the object already travel 2 radian. How much is 1 radian? Yeah, how much is 1 radian? 1 radian based on the equation here, yeah, is equal to r times theta. Yeah, so 1 radian is theta simply just changed by 1. Yeah, if theta is 1, then s is equal to r. Means when the object has traveled a circle, an arc of a circle equal to the radius of the circle, is called 1 radian. Yeah. So if the wave already travel half of the circle, then we call it p radian or 3.14. Yeah. And if only the full circle is 2π radian. Okay. So in this case, 2 radian per second means 2 times. 2 times. The diameter, the radius of the circle, yeah. Okay, 2 times the radius of the circle. Yeah. In 1 second, already traveled 2 times the radius. Yeah, 2 times the radius of the circle. Okay. So we have this formula here, yeah, which is analogous. Analogous is alike. Yeah. This is also alike. You can see just change x with theta and omega with v. Yeah. And then all will be all right. We have the acceleration, the translational, we have the rotational acceleration. The difference is with alpha, which is in radian per second square. Yeah. Now, so we have here the formulas, just like in linear motion. Yeah, if you know the formula here, and I think I'm sure that you are already familiar with the linear motion, you don't have much problems to do the same for rotational motion. Yeah, because we have this analogy. Yeah. For example, we have a problem which is actually a rotational problem. Yeah. The blades of an electric blender are whirling with an angular velocity. So just identify angular velocity, 375 radian per second. Don't be afraid with such problems. It's just a matter of practice, yeah. And then the second velocity after you operate this is 40. When the blend button is pressed, the blades accelerate, reach a greater angular velocity. Okay, we don't know this, yeah. After the blades have rotated through an angular displacement, so we have theta here, 44 radians, which is the blade already circle 44 times the radius of the circle. Yeah, so 44 radian means 44 times the radius. If the radius of the circle is 10 centimeter, then it already move around 440 centimeter, right? Or 4 meters 40 centimeters. Simple as that. Yeah, the acceleration is 1740, which is very huge, I think, radian seconds. Find the final angular velocity. This is not so hard. Yeah. Well, I already know the answer. No, I don't know. I just read this problem the same time as you just read. The difference that I have 20 years of experience. Yeah. So what I do is I remember this formula. V squared is equal to V squared plus 2AS, which is the formula for constant acceleration, right? So we have this analogy. Yeah, you can guess omega squared is equal to omega zero squared plus 2 alpha and theta here. So no problem. We want to know omega 2. Yeah. We have this analogy here. Just put the numbers in. Yeah. Just put the numbers in and you are okay then. Yeah. Omega zero is here 375, square it. Alpha, you already have 1740. Theta, you have 44. So you have all the things that you need to calculate omega. Yeah, so omega is actually just the square of this. Yeah. Square root, yeah? The square root. So, yeah. So when you have this problem, remember the linear analogy. This is a motion with constant angular acceleration. So, yeah, as I've said before, yeah, sometimes it's best to try yourself, take a piece of paper, be happy and do the problems. Yeah, if you don't understand, look at my lecture again. Then close my lecture and do your problem by yourself. Yeah, it is very important, yeah, in studying and in mastering something, anything, by doing yourself. Yeah, convince yourself by do the own calculation. Yeah. The problem maybe that you have so far, sometimes you just don't have enough experience to try by yourself. So just do your calculation, do it relax, yeah. If you cannot do, then just find another time. You feel the mood to do this, do it, and then you get the answer. You feel some excitement. Use your calculator for calculating. If you don't wanna do it yourself, it's okay. Yeah. So the answer when you do it is 542 radian per second. Yeah. It is always a good experience if you can find the answer by yourself. Yeah, so when, for example, you have centripetal here, yeah, centripetal acceleration. What is centripetal acceleration? An object that moves in a circle always require a force that pull the object into the circle. Yeah. If not, then the object will move in a straight line. The object will move in a straight line, but because of the centripetal acceleration, it will follow a circle. Yeah, this is what happens with gravity. The Earth is circling the Sun because of there is a force which is the gravitational force that pull the Earth towards the Sun. Yeah, because the Earth has initial velocity, then the trajectory is ellipse. Yeah. So in the same, for example, maybe you already watch a cowboy movie, and the lasso to be able to circle above your head, you have to give some pull on the rope. Yeah. So this is the application of lasso. Yeah. And for example, you are playing merry-go-round in the, let's say in the amusement park. Yeah, amusement park. So like you feel like you, when you move in the circle, you feel like your body wants to be thrown out. Yeah, it's because you feel the friction force. Yeah, friction force which is trying to pull you out. Yeah, this is actually a friction force because you are moving in a circle, so you are not in a constant velocity. Yeah, this is called centrifugal force. Yeah. This is experienced only by a person which is moving with the circle, in the circle. For example, you're moving in a merry-go-round. Yeah. But from the outside, there is only one force, which is the centripetal force, pulling you into the center, but you never reach the center because you have tangential velocity. Yeah. So in uniform circular motion, you always have this uniform angular momentum. The tangential speed, yeah, which is the translational speed, is always directed parallel to the acceleration. So the acceleration is to the left, the velocity tangential is upwards in this case, yeah. It's always perpendicular to the acceleration. Yeah, you may think that this is simple, yeah. But this is simple only because the acceleration, angular acceleration is constant. If the angular acceleration is not constant, you will move in a spiral, not like in a full circle like this. Okay, which is another case which we not discuss because, yeah. So you can see here the acceleration can be calculated, which is the centripetal acceleration is equal to V squared divided by R. Yeah. Okay. How do we get this? Remember, the formula of Newton is sigma F. Every formula can be derived here. And you have a MA is equal to, when you have a, we have this condition, yeah. Okay, there's actually a way to derive this, yeah. So, yeah. So, the centripetal force, yeah, centripetal force is the only force that is acting. The centripetal force is given by mv squared divided by r. This you can find the derivation in the books, yeah, like Kapner and so on. So we have mv squared divided by r. So m is the same, so the acceleration, which is the translational acceleration, is equal to V squared by I. But this itself here, the derivation of this, you can find in the books, yeah. Find in the books. Okay, so In this case, yeah, it's very important to understand that from a person outside the circle here, there is only one acceleration. So it's motion in constant acceleration. A net force causes linear motion to change. But what causes the rotational motion? There must be an analogy. We have the analogy of theta r omega v alpha analogy. So what is the analogy of F? We will learn right now after this, yeah, that this is something to do with a quantity called the torque, yeah, the torque, yeah, the torque. In Indonesia is torka, yeah, it is something related with a quantity called torka. So the torque, yeah, you see theta is equal to, let's say this is S, yeah, R times S omega is equal to R times V, right? Alpha is related to R times A. Yeah, R is apa? What is R? Radian. So we'll learn later, yeah, the torque Q is something related to R and F, yeah? So it's of the R here. Yeah, am I correct or not? I think S is equal to, okay, so I'm sorry, I think I make a mistake, yeah, so S is equal to, so theta is equal to S divided by R, sorry, V divided by R, alpha divided by R. R here is the radius, it's dimensionless, so the radius is in meter, yeah. So you have meter divided by meter, which is non-dimensional, is non-dimensional or unity. Yeah? Omega is meter per seconds divided by meter. So the unit of omega is 1 per seconds. The unit of alpha is 1 per second squared. Yeah? Radius per second is just 1 per second. Radius per second squared. Radius per meter. Radius per second square. Okay. Yeah, so you have this relation here. The torque is unit is meter times force is Newton. Just Newton meter, meter kilogram meter per second square, which is kilogram meter square per second square. This is the dimension of the torque. Yeah. The dimension of the torque is this. Okay, so it is not the net external force, but rather the net external torque that causes the rotational velocity to change. Yeah. So, for example, you have a motion in a circle. Not always is the velocity, the rotational velocity is not always the same. If we have a net torque, it's not equal to zero, then we have velocity one is not equal to velocity two. The angular velocity, yeah. Okay, so very simple application is when you try to push a door, yeah. Try to open a door. You will have the handle here. Yeah. This is just a simple handle. Means you have to give the force in this direction to open the door. You have what is called here the hinge, yeah, which is this axis of rotation. And from the axis of rotation, you have a distance here. Call this distance R. Yeah. Again, yeah, when you apply, you have this distance. So what is R? R is the distance from the hinge or axis of rotation to the where you apply the force. All right, yeah, So in this case, I make a mistake then here, yeah. R is not equal to this, but R is equal to from only from this to here. So R is equal to the distance from the hinge to the point where the force is applied, right? Yeah. So in this case, which has the higher torque, A or B? Okay. I may ask Raihan. Raihan, can you turn on the voice for just 1 minute? Raihan, can you turn on the mic?
Yes, sir.
Simple question, Raihan. If you can look at picture A and picture B from your logic, yeah, which one has a higher torque? Picture A or picture B? What is the definition of torque? In this case, torque is equal to R cross F, yeah, right? If the force is the same, yeah, this is vector, this is also vector. If the force is the same, which one has a bigger R, A or B? Just from the picture here, which R is longer, A or B?
A.
Right. Because A is longer, which torque is higher? Torque A or torque B?
A.
Yeah, right. Why? Because RA is longer than RB, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. You can turn off your microphone. So, yeah, this is the reason when you open the door, yeah, the doorknob is located in the edge, not in the middle, because you only need to apply smaller force, yeah, if the force is not the same, you only need to apply smaller force rather than here, because you already are held by the long air, yeah. Okay, so this is also the same. For example, in this case, there is a huge object and you want to move the object, so you use a lever, right? Yeah, so the distance is like this. Because why? Because then when you apply a force, the R is already long, large, yeah? So only small f can already move this object, and it will move, yeah? This is concept of leverage. It's concept of leverage, yeah? So you will learn about this later. Yeah, so that's the reason why the doorknob is on the edge. The door doesn't open up quickly if you apply the same force at a point closer to the hinge. Yeah, because the torque is then less. The torque will be less. Right. Another point, if you push you give the force not perpendicular, but the force is rather horizontal. Yeah, so you have the torque is defined as, remember, R comes first, yeah? R first, then F. R cross F is in trigonometry equal as RF, yeah, which is the absolute value RF times cosinus or sinus, yeah? So R cross F is equal to RF cosinus theta. What is theta? The theta is the here you have R, here you have R. Theta is the angle between R and F. Yeah, in this case, angle R is 90. Yeah, this is wrong. This is sinus. Okay, sorry, sinus. So sinus 90 is how much? Zakia, can you turn on your mic?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Zakia, if the angle is 90, how much is sinus 90?
One.
Right. Yes. How much is sinus zero?
Zero.
Yeah. In this case, A and B, and you look at this. Sinus 90, and let's say this is sinus 30. Which one produce higher torque? Sinus 90 or sinus 30?
So minus 90.
Yeah, that is the reason why B is better or A is better than C, right?
Yes.
Okay, you can turn off your mic. So yeah, yeah. Remember that the torque is given by sinus, right? Okay. So the best way to open a door is using concept of A. Yeah. So maybe in daily life we act because of the instinct, yeah, on our feelings, on our daily experience. But in physics, there is always explanation. Yeah, there is always explanation. Okay. Yeah. Also, this is one of the reason for a bus driver. Okay. I can ask one of you again. I like to interact. Yeah. Okay, Muhammad Ihsan. Yeah. Hello, Muhammad Ihsan.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. For a bus driver. Yeah. Usually the radius of the what we call this. What we call the in Indonesia it's setir, yeah. What we call this in English? Any ideas? What is this in English? The control, yeah, for turning the wheel, yeah, the driving wheel, yeah. Let's say the driving wheel. For a bus driver or truck driver, usually the radius of the driving wheel is larger or smaller than normal car?
Larger.
Larger.
Yes.
Why it's larger? You have some guess why usually it's make larger than normal car? Based on the torque principle. Yeah.
Because more along the...
Yes.
The wheel, the driver wheel
radius, yeah.
The radius, then the torque will can easily the turn can yeah. be turned easily.
Yeah. So with smaller force, we can easily turn the wheel, right? The driving wheel. Okay. Okay. Thank you for your explanation. Yeah. So yeah, it's correct. Yeah, Muhammad Ihsan. Yeah, as you said. Yeah, longer radius is more easy to rotate, yeah, more easy to rotate. Okay, I think I have a class with bright student here, yeah. So, Ding Ang Ni, can you turn on your mic?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so Ding, sorry if I ask, yeah. It's not too difficult, but maybe you remember about when you watch movie that someone can. For example, in circus, yeah, someone can move in above the rope, yeah. In circus, there is a person who can move along the rope, but usually they use like a stick, yeah, large stick, yeah. From the lecture that you already hear from now, can you try to find the reason why this person use this long stick to balance? From the logic, yeah, maybe. Here I can draw for you, yeah. So for example, this is the rope, yeah, and then this is the person walking on the rope, yeah, and you see she or he holds a like a what we call it a large balance, yeah, it's this stick, large balance stick, yeah. So so for the person to not falling down require that the torque on the left and the torque on the right must be the same, right? Yeah. So Ding Ang, can you turn on your mic again? Hello? Yeah. So can you explain the reason why the person has to use this balance usually? From your point of view, what is the use of this? What happened when the person walks along the rope? The person has a center of gravity, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And the center of gravity sometimes can move to the left or to the right because the person is not always stable. Yeah. So what happens if the person wants to fall to the left? Like, oh, I'm going to fall to the left. What she needs to do? She has to balance herself again, right?
Yeah.
Right. If the person falls to the left, then she feel that the torque is more high on the left, for example, in this case. So what must she do? She should rotate the balance to the right, right? Yeah,
to the right.
Yeah. So she can move the balance lower to the right. So the center of mass will not turn back to the middle again. If she wants to fall into the right, she have to lower the balance to the left. So then the center of gravity move again. Yeah. So this is a interplay of balance, and with the balance stick she can do it more easily than without the balance stick. Yeah, without the balance stick usually then the person will put the hands like this, yeah, so to balance. Okay, so this is the application of torque in circus. Yeah, okay, udah. So yeah, okay. So this is the application. Yeah, thank you for your answer. Okay, so it's interesting, yeah, today's lecture. Yeah. Okay, I'm in the mood to ask questions. No, Pavin, hello Pavin. Pavin Kumar. Yeah. So Pavin, you already know Formula One, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, Formula One. I give you an example like this. You know, this is a bottle of ketchup, right?
All right.
If the bottle of ketchup is full, and if the bottle of ketchup is not full or half full, which one is more balanced? When I put this on the floor like this, yeah, and then I try to disturb the ketchup, yeah, the bottle will fall down more easily if it's full or half full. What is your guess?
So maybe if it's are full, then it's easy to drop.
If it's full, it's easy to drop.
Half full.
Half full.
Yeah.
Okay. How if the bottle is less than half full? Let's say 1/4 or a quarter. Which one is easier to drop? When I move it like this, which one is easier?
So 1/4.
Yeah, 1/4 is then less than this, eh? Less than half.
Okay.
Yeah, which one is then easier to fall? If it's half full or less than half?
Less than half.
Think again. Yeah. Yeah. Look, this is not falling. Yeah. But when it is full, it is easier to fall actually, because the center of gravity is higher. Yeah. So the center of gravity, if the bottle is full, it's higher to topple it down. If it's half full, it's not so easy to topple it down.
Oh, all right, sir.
Right. So when the center of gravity is lower, meaning that it's more stable, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So can you take this analogy to Formula One? Formula One cars are very, very, what we call,
stable.
Very, very, yeah, less high. Yeah. So let's say close to the ground. Yeah. Why is that so? Can you give a reason? Why is the Formula One car is very close to the ground?
So is it maybe because of the design of the Formula One car?
Yeah, design. Why is designed like that?
So it's to withstand the high air resistance.
Right. And also, what is its relation with stability? What is relation with equilibrium? Can you give more explanation? Because the center of gravity is lower than normal car or larger than or higher than normal car?
Lower, sir.
Yeah, lower. Because it's lower, the stability is higher or not?
No.
Actually, because this is lower, then the stability is higher, you know? Because let's this. If the bottle is only 1/4 full, then the center of mass is closer to the ground, yeah? If the center of mass is closer to the ground, then when they topple, when they topple left to the right, they will easily come back to the middle. So in this case, the Formula One car are more stable than normal car because the center of gravity is lower. Can you grasp this? Yeah. So this is the reason why Formula One car are very stable because they are very close to the ground. Yeah.
Right, sir.
Okay. Thank you for your answer.
Thank you.
Yeah. So this is the analogy. Yeah. Okay. Let me move on with the lecture. Yeah. So the torque Q depends on the magnitude of the force and also the distance. Yeah. If a force is parallel to the door's plane, then there will not move because sinus is no zero. Yeah. Sinus is no zero. If applied perpendicular, it will maximize the torque. Yeah. And remember, torque is given by R cross F. Yeah. Vector. This is vector multiplication or cross product. A cross product is sinus. Yeah. So, what is line of action? Line of action is extended line drawn collinear with the force. So, if we have this connection, yeah. So the line of action is simple from the axis of rotation, and this is the force. Yeah, you meet in this here. This is called L, is the line of action. Yeah. Okay. What is the application? The magnitude of the torque is actually the multiplication of the line of action times the force. Yeah. So line of force is then defined as L is then as R sin theta. Yeah. You can look at the picture, yeah. You have R, you have F. For example, F is here. Yeah. What is L? Yeah. L is this. Yeah. This is from the axis of rotation. L. What is L? Yeah. L is ini theta. Sorry, theta is R and F, yeah. Yeah. Theta is then line of force is R sin theta. Yeah, but what, so R sin theta is then given by is the same. Yeah. Okay, so L is R sin theta. Now, when is the torque positive? When the force tend to produce a counterclockwise rotation above the axis, and negative when the force tends to produce a clockwise rotation. Simple is like this. Yeah. If you have R and this is F, yeah, R cross F is equal to torque, yeah. Nah, so if R cross F, yeah. You see, R cross F is means you put your four fingers, yeah. You put your four fingers on the direction of R, and then you rotate the four fingers to the direction of F. Your middle finger is pointing at your nose, yeah. Okay, pointing at you. So in this case, the torque is positive because you can see rotation here from R to F is counterclockwise or opposite to the clock direction. Now, for example, when R is to the left and F is to the top above, yeah. So R cross F is now in the clockwise rotation, and the torque direction is moving into the laptop or inside, far from your face, yeah, farther from your face. So, for example, you have X here, Cartesian, you have Y, yeah. X, yeah. Cross Y, what is X cross Y? Is in the positive Z direction. Is equal to Z, yeah. But Y cross X is in the negative Z, yeah. So, if it's produced counterclockwise, then it is positive, and then in the if it's clockwise, then it's negative. Yeah. So in this case, you can see what do I do is usually I just extend my this R here. I just extend this R and put it here. Yeah. So R, this is theta there. Yeah. Listen, R cross theta is in clockwise direction. Yeah. R cross theta is in clockwise direction. So in this case, the torque is negative, pointing into farther from your face, yeah, into the screen. Yeah. So pointing in the opposite direction to your face. Yeah. okay, so yeah, R cross F. Yeah, because R cross F, vector of R is in the right. F is here. So R cross F pointing clockwise. So for the equilibrium rigid body, you need all the requirement is three. For two dimensional case, you need fx0, fy0, and also torque must be zero. So you have an additional requirement. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, this is an example of our problem. Yeah. We have, for example, this axis and homogeneous, let's say stick or something. Yeah. And then we have the mass of gravity if this homogeneous is in the middle. And then we have another force, pull force, which is vertical and to the upward, yeah, and two down force, yeah. So we have three forces acting on the body. So the first thing you have to calculate to produce equilibrium is you have to calculate that the torque is zero, yeah. So there are three torque, two downwards, one upwards. This is clockwise direction. F2 and F1 is clockwise going back down, so it's negative. So we have this condition, and if you know the forces, you just calculate this. Yeah. So the key is to calculate that the total torque must be zero. Yeah. So the point where height is considered to act as a whole is the center of gravity is in the middle if the object is homogeneous. Yeah, have the same density. Yeah, center of gravity. Okay. For example, in this case, the center of gravity is in the middle. Yeah, but it can also shift if you have a force acting on the like a weight on the top. Yeah, so the center of gravity can be determined by calculating the net torque. Yeah, created by the box and given by this formula here. Okay. It's better for you to try to do with your own. Yeah. For example, here the problem. Yeah. In gymnastics, yeah, or also in body anatomy, yeah, you have this upper arm, lower arm, and hand. Each of you have center of gravity. Each of the part has center of gravity. And you have the distance, yeah, between the upper arm and lower arm. Yeah. So by calculating, yeah, the total torque, we can find the center of gravity. Yeah. Yeah. So you can see here, omega, W1x1 plus W2x2 divided by the total. Then the center of gravity of all the three things, of all the three system here, is given by 0.28, yeah, from this axis, 0.28 is around this, yeah. So this is the center of gravity, yeah. Okay, so yeah, this is the reason, yeah. Now I have a question which I want to ask to Suganti. Hello, Suganti.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. What do you think the center of gravity of a woman and man is the same or different?
I think it's the same.
It's the same, but let's think about the anatomy of the body of woman and man. It's not the same, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So from your logical guessing, yeah, which one has higher center of gravity, woman or man?
Man.
I think because of the anatomy, yeah, women tend to have higher center of gravity. Right? So it's not the same. But what I mean is, based on the physics, yeah, if there is a woman and a man sitting on a chair, she or he has to move the chair by rotation. Yeah, let's say she cannot lift the chair, but she can only move the body. Which one is easier to move, the woman or the man? Which one has the higher center of gravity?
Sorry, so can you repeat your question?
Yeah, for example, there is a woman and a man sitting on a chair, the same height, the same chair.
Okay.
Right? So, and then they have to rotate the chair by standing up. But when they stand up, they must not lift the chair. So, I mean, the body must still contact with the chair. Right? So, when they stand up, the body must still contact with the chair. Which one is easier to move, the woman or the man? Which one has easier ability to move the chair, the woman or the man, based on the center of gravity?
Woman, maybe.
Yes, right. Because the woman has higher center of yeah, gravity. The higher the center of gravity, the higher the torque, yeah, because then the distance from the rotation of the axis from the floor to the center of gravity is larger, right? The distance is larger.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So thank you for your answer. So you can see that physics is in everyday life, everywhere. Yeah. Even when you stand up from your chair, or you play any games that is rotational, then you have to involve the concept of torque. Yeah. So, great. So, this is the explanation. Yeah. The finding the center of gravity for arbitrary shape can be done using this method. Yeah. So you put the lever into non-stability and then you calculate. Yeah. You calculate here by moving in a different orientation. Yeah. And then you take the first the line here, yeah, and then you install it again with a different point, and then it will again have stability, yeah, when you have this one, yeah, and you have then this one. So the intersection between the two points here, this is the center of gravity here, yeah. The intersection between the two points is called the center of gravity or center of mass. Okay. Yeah. So the key is to hang it with two different orientation. Yeah. So, and then you will learn about simple mechanical matching and advantage. Yeah. So a machine in this case is a device for multiplying force or simply changing the direction of the force. Blah blah blah. I feel just move on with the next. Yeah. So we have the ideal mechanical advantage, actual mechanical advantage. It's usually in the technical construction. Yeah, if you want to learn about construction, you have to understand this. Ideal mechanical advantage is that input force multiply under ideal condition, where we don't consider any friction at all. But the real thing is the actual mechanical advantage. It's best when I give you example like this. Actual mechanical advantage is by ratio of the forces, the out force produced by the in force. For example, you have lever like this. Yeah, this is the leverage, and then you have the okay. You have two forces, yeah. Yeah, this is the input. And this is the output. So, actual mechanical advantage is output divided by input. Yeah, this is the actual AMA, yeah. But for IMA, ideal, ideal mechanical advantage is L1, and this is L2. Ideal, this is AMA. IMA is L2 divided by L1. L1 divided by L2. L1 divided by L2. IMA is always larger than AMA. Ideal is always larger than AMA. So, if for example, this is 2 meter, this is 1 meter. Good. I want to ask, let's see, who is this? Okay, we have more women than men here, yeah. Okay, Sabina, hello. Okay, can you turn on the mic? Yes. So here, for example, we have 1 meter for L1 and 1 meter for L2. Which one? Which is the IMA? Can you calculate IMA? Can you calculate IMA? IMA is L1 divided by L2, right? So how much is this? Is L1 is 2, L2 is 1. Hello? Yeah, hello Sabina, hello?
Sorry. My connection.
So how much, how do you calculate IMA? Is what divided by what? L1 divided by?
Yes.
L1 is how much? How many meters?
2 divided by 1.
Yeah, which is 2, right? Okay. Now, if my input force is 1,000 Newton, and my output force is 1,500 Newton, how much is AMA? divided by 1,000, right?
Yes, sir.
How much is this?
1.5.
Yeah, what is your conclusion? IMA is always larger than AMA, right?
Yes.
If the maximum is IMA is 2, yeah, as you said, yeah. The maximum IMA is 2. If the force input is 1,000 Newton, what is the maximum force output? What is the maximum force output if it's the same as IMA? If 1,000 Newton is input, how much is the maximum output? Okay, I ask you again. How much is the IMA?
2.
Yeah. If input is 1,000, how much is output? Just 1,000 multiply by?
2.
Which is? How much? 1,000 multiplied by 2, how much?
1,000.
2,000, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So what is your conclusion? If we know IMA, we can calculate the maximum ideally force, right? We can calculate, but in the reality, the output is never the same as the IMA. You know what I mean? The output is always less than 2,000 because of friction and so on, right?
Yes.
Okay, thank you for your answer.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so this is the conclusion of this IMA and AMA. It's actually just like this, yeah. And you can calculate this, for example, if you already know, IMA is output, input is actually not the same, yeah. This is actually wrong, yeah. IMA is always S input and S output. But AMA is F output, F input. Yeah. Oh yeah? So the effectivity is then AMA divided by IMA, because AMA is always lower than IMA, yeah. So efficiency is 100% if AMA is equal to IMA. Yeah. Yeah. So we have mechanical advantage in the form which can be calculated like this. Yeah. Input work is always the same as output work, but the force can be smaller if we have longer longer distance here. Okay, and we can calculate here the torque transmission. This is just I think only for the advanced student, yeah, but it's not too hard actually, because the force is equal to the torque, yeah. Torque is equal to force times air. So AMA in the rotational motion is the same as in the translational, but the difference is now we change the force with torque, yeah. We change the torque with torque. It's always the same, yeah. The difference is only we change the force with the torque. Yeah. So we can also calculate for the inclined plane. IMA is then S in, yeah. S in is this one, and S out is the height, yeah. S out is the height. How we determine S in and S out? Yeah, S in is the distance travel, S out is the actual height change, yeah. For large L, yeah, the H here is disappearing. Yeah, for large L, we can neglect this, yeah. But only if the L is quite large, yeah. And AMA is F out is which equal to the weight, F in is equal to the push. Okay, it's not too hard actually, yeah. Just try to do with yourself. Yeah. How to determine the F out and F in, yeah. F in is always the force that given by your hand. So F in is here. And F out is the force that is produced by your action, which is this in this case, produce is the weight. Yeah, change in the weight. The weight is the same, but I mean when you push, yeah, you push against what? You will produce force which is equal to the weight. Yeah. Okay, let's move on. Yeah, we have here many cases. Yeah, the mechanical advantage. Look, mechanical advantage. You know, the force is equal, but because the distance is twice. Yeah, in the first case and the second case. Yeah, so in the second case, the mechanical advantage is two because the force is 120, but you only need to input only 60 because of air is twice longer than here. Yeah, air here is the distance is air, but now the distance is twice to air, so to air only half the force. Yeah, this is for the pulley. Yeah, and this is the same. Yeah, so mechanical system average here because the distance is twice. Then only IMA is 2, yeah, because now the input force is only 2. See, we neglect friction here, yeah, we neglect friction here. Yeah, here you can calculate IMA dan AMA. AMA is all F out per F in, yeah, 500, 260, and 25 per 26. Also in Maskell Achilles, yeah, you can calculate, yeah, that. This is actually application of physics in daily life, anatomy, yeah. And they can apply this laws of physics to any system actually, even the bones, yeah, muscle and so on. Yeah. The torque can be calculated by F times R. Yeah, yeah, you can read this in the book. Yeah, yeah. And so I'm not going to discuss this further because it's better to look by yourself. Yeah. Also this kind, yeah, of problems, I think you should read by yourself. The point here is the total torque in equilibrium is equal to zero. Yeah. Okay, thank you for your participation. Now I have like 10 to 5 minutes for any questions. Yeah. Is there any question? Okay, if there is no question, then see you in Friday, yeah, at 1 p.m. for practicum. Okay, I hope that this lecture is interesting, yeah. So if you don't have any question, I will stop this meeting. Thank you for your attention. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, everyone.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Bye-bye.